Good morning, Grace Church.
Good morning.
Happy Independence Day. We're like 4 months past a year ago when they told us to be sheltered in. Time flies. We're in the seventh month of this year. I'm glad to see you've come out to worship in church, those in the parking lot are 90.7, and we're live streaming on YouTube. Check out your bulletins. They're available digitally. The office will send it to you. 100 years ago, yesterday, on the 3rd, we opened up this sanctuary, and we're going to be celebrating it this month with an art reception and a picnic, and worship and praise. So blessed to have such a beautiful place. Next week, we start 10:30. Set your clocks. There's a lot. Yeah, you have alarms on them. Set your clock. Next week is 10:30. The Bible, Brats and Burgers is upcoming. And check out that virtual university. Let's see. Welcome. Pastor Don.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
It is a great joy to be here. I know that we're still getting used to changes and changes in our worship order. And one of those changes is that we take up our offering first. Now, some people will be, Pastor, why we do it that way? But my thing is that I think that if we go ahead and get offering out of the way and we come prepared to give God an offering, and we can come prepared to also offer to God our cares and our concerns. And so we lift all those up. And so those who haven't been given yet, the usher is still around to give you that opportunity to give before we go into blessing the offering. And in that blessing of the offering, we not only bless the offering, we bless those other cares and concerns that you have filled out on the slips and put into the offering plate. I want to assure you that weekly, we have a prayer group that prays over every prayer request and prays over every name. Not just say, God bless them, but they call you by name. And so we lift up to God both our cares, our concerns, our desires, and our offering and our gifts. So now, if you would bring those forward, and we will bless them at this time, and then we will begin with our doxology after that. Let us pray. Ever-present God who speaks in thunder and earthquakes, and in the softest whispers, we long to hear your voice over all the noise of the world this day. In a world so divided and polarized, we need to hear not only the voice of the shepherd, but the cries of other sheep who are being marginalized, forgotten, and abandoned. May the gifts we offer today be a response to hearing the one who speaks in the language of love and compassion. In his holy name, amen. All blessings, praise God, I saw people here below. Praise Holy Spirit evermore. Praise Triune God, whom we adore. Amen. You may be seated.
The change for the week. The Fresh Air Fellowship will be on Thursday evening. You can RSVP at the office. It's in the bulletin. It's time for centering as we approach the opening prayer. That's putting our feet on the floor, hands in our lap, faced up, and three breaths to connect us with the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Our opening prayer is adopted from the Book of Common Prayer. It's titled Freedom. Gracious God, you have made all the peoples of the earth for your glory. You invite us to serve you in freedom and in peace. Give to the people of our nation a zeal for justice and the strength for forbearance, that we may use our liberty in accordance with your gracious will. We ask this on the day of celebration, a day of hope for the nation made free. We ask this in the name of the one who welcomes all to be free indeed. Inspire us to live and worship in your freedom and for the sake of your kingdom. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me for the call to worship. Take off your shoes.
We are standing on holy ground.
Shake off the dust.
We are ready to start afresh.
Let us worship God and receive Christ's teaching, that we may be renewed and strengthened.
Amen. Let us stand together for our affirmation of faith. There are many different affirmations of faith that we do. I know some of us are familiar with one in particular, but this is another affirmation of faith that we want to present to you this morning. And let us read it together. As followers of Jesus Christ, living in this world, which some seek to control, but which others view with despair, we declare with joy and trust, our world belongs to God. From the beginning through all the crises of our times, until his kingdom fully comes, God keeps covenant forever. Our world belongs to God. God is king, Let the earth be glad. Christ is victor. His rule has begun. Hallelujah. The Spirit is at work, renewing creation. Praise the Lord. We rejoice in the goodness of God, renounce the works of darkness, and dedicate ourselves to holy living. As covenant partners, called to faith obedience, we set free for joyful praise. We offer our hearts and lives to do God's work in God's world with tempered impatience, eager to see justice ended. Eager to see injustice ended, we expect the day of the Lord, and we are confident that the light which shines in the present darkness will fill the earth when Christ appears. Come, Lord Jesus, our world belongs to you. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
Left that place where Jairus' daughter was raised from the dead and where the woman with the hemorrhage had been cured. And he came to his hometown, and the disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did this man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary and brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief.
Then he went about around the villages teaching, and he called the disciples, the 12, to him and sent them out. He began to send them out two by two with authority to cast out the unclean spirits. And he told them to take nothing with them, except for a staff. No bread, no bag, no money in their belt, but to wear sandals and to not take two tunics. And he told them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave that place. And if a place does not welcome you and will not listen to what you have to say, as you leave, shake off the dust from your feet as a testimony against them." So the disciples went out, proclaiming that all should repent. They cast out many demons, and they anointed with oil many who were sick, and they cured them. These are stories of Jesus from the Word of God for all people.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
time and the harvest, our life, our health, our food.
Who gives it thee to offer for all thy love and lies?
But that which thou desirest, our humble, thankful heart.
We are a congregation of prayer. I know some of you may be saying, Pastor, you have many prayers in this bulletin. It is because we have been taught that we are to always pray. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let us pray together. Thank you, God, for being our God. We know that our God is always on time. Our God doesn't waste time. Our God makes time and teach us what it looks like to make good use of our time on this earth. Our time is limited. Our time must be managed. Our time is out of our hands to the point that we must pause for our spiritual health's sake, to remember who our time falls under. Our time under God is time well spent. Under God, we recognize how God is helping us through our weakness. Our time under God puts rest and self-care into perspective. Without God, our time is overwhelming impact. Our time is underwater with the world's problem. Our time is under arrest, easily kept from God's promise. Thank you, God, for allowing our time to be under you and not limited to our ways of doing things. Amen. Today, I want to remind you of the kingdom and what we are called to be a part of. Because whatever Jesus Christ is doing in the world, however Jesus Christ is working, he chooses not to do it without humankind. Jesus sends out the most unlikeliest of people to do his work, people like you and me. There is much that we might not understand about Jesus and his mission. We may be filled with doubts and misgivings. And yet, what is Jesus' great plan for winning back the world to himself? What is that great plan? It is us. Today, we want to welcome you to the story of the founding of the church. I know many of you thought that the church started at Pentecost. But I will argue that the church starts when Jesus sent others out to do the work that Jesus was doing. This morning, we've actually heard the tellers tell two stories. One story about Jesus' rejection by his own family, his own people, his own community. And the other story is Jesus sending out his disciples. It may be possible that Jesus' rejection by his family and those of his hometown initiated his decision to send out others to proclaim the good news of the gospel which he was proclaiming. Throughout Mark's gospel, a major concern is the identity of Jesus. Everybody's asking, who is this person? It seems like that was on everyone's mind. Rulers, religious leaders, authorities, crowds, disciples, and even family members cannot figure out who he is or what he is trying to do. Some of you may be still wrestling with that idea yourself, that you wrestle with the narratives about Jesus. And you ask, what does it mean for this community? What does it mean for our world that Jesus has come? What does it mean? And some of us look at those stories and we believe in them, but others of us, we doubtfully waver between opinions concerning him. What does it mean that he lives? Today, I assure you that if you have doubts about Jesus, you are in a large company. Even his own family was confused. On the other hand, if you believe in Jesus and have faith in him, congratulations. You are part of the happy minority who know who Jesus is. This morning, gospel lesson set before us the founding of the Christian church prior to the experience of Pentecost. Jesus selects a team of people like you and me to proclaim and deliver the message of God's reign and that God is coming and that God is near. He selected people like you and he selected people like me to continue the work that he was engaged in. And these people he selected, guess what? They performed signs and wonders to indicate that the time of change has come. Just like the change of an administration, there are different things to expect. There are new things on the horizon, and these 12 went out to declare you're under a new management, that there is love under a new management. Going head to head with the powers of those religious leaders, the power of governmental leaders, the power of the demonic, those 12 were sent out to address all of those things and to perform and proclaim and perform miracles and to proclaim to all people that people are capable of transforming. Form living. So they go head to head with the demonic and they perform acts of healing. The 12 whom Jesus appoints there as their ambassadors. They're ambassadors to the kingdom that is unfolding, and they're just like us. How are they just like us? They misunderstand Jesus from the very beginning. They are baffled by Jesus' parables. They never seem to get the point of his teaching. They are spellbound by his miracles. When Jesus performed some miraculous acts, they seem as befuddled and baffled as the crowds who clamor after him. Jesus says that they are full of fear and lack faith, causing them to ask, when he calms the storm at the sea, who is this? So he calls the 12 and sent them out in pairs. He gave them authority over unclean spirits. He instructed them to take nothing for the journey except a walking stick. No bread, no bags, and no money in their belts. So they went out and proclaimed that people should change their hearts and lives. They cast out many demons and they anointed many sick people. So Mark begins his gospel announcing that Jesus is the long-awaited Messiah from God. And so the audience, when they hear this, they're already expecting that some miraculous things will happen. But there is an unexpected twist to the story. The unexpected twist to the story is because this Messiah, the one who's claimed to be the Son of God, he turns around. and dedicated his Masonic saving, world-transforming work to a group of ordinary folks. Just imagine that they were looking for the magic man. They were looking for the man that would make everything different. They were looking for the man that changes the world. They were looking for a Messiah, but this Messiah turns around and delegates all that he was doing and delegate the promise to the hands of ordinary people. He gave them the gifts to go out and change the world. So we actually are seeing the birth of the church, because that's what we're called to be. That's what we're called to be. We're called to be the light of the world, the salt of the earth. We're called to change the way that life is here in this kingdom. We can kind of think of Jesus gathering those 12s, maybe after we're celebrating the 4th of July, we probably can kind of think that of that first U.S. Constitutional Convention. You know, a few men came together and they gathered with the idea of founding a new republic. I'm not sure that the men who gathered there, whether they had any idea what they were proposing would work. I am sure that they were unaware of how limiting their work was and who was left out of their deliberation. The 4th of July is a time to step back and take stock of our nation. If we do that, then we often, in a reflective mood, we make a critical assessment of our nation. How can we be a better? How can we be a better people? What might our nation do to be a true democracy with blessings for all? Can you imagine that just like the start of the nation, the witness of the Christian church started with a small group of people who dare to change the world? In this story of Jesus' calling and sending of the disciples, explains why you and I are here this morning. The first disciples are the precursors for all of us. It is a witness to the fact that God does not work solo. I'm going to say that again to you, that God does not work solo. Maybe you thought because God is omnipotent and omnipresent that God does everything and anything that God wants all by God's self. But we have the story of a God who comes to us as Jesus the Christ, who comes to us and calls ordinary people to work with God. Jesus acts as the great delegator, the Savior who chooses not to save the world by himself. Jesus sends these ordinary people out to do the same things that he does. Had any of the disciples had any previous medical training? I doubt that they had. Now, I know some of you are saying, well, Pastor, what about Luke? But in reality, Luke never met Jesus. So no medical training, and yet they're sent out to do miraculous healing work. What a way to inaugurate and carry through God's new kingdom. And yet it is Jesus' way of doing things. I'm not going into great detail to illustrate to you how you, your wonderful, ordinary self, that you are the best illustration of the truth of this biblical passage. That when you live as the community of God, you are the best illustration of the healing of God, the working of miracles, the restorer of justice. Perhaps some of you have reservations about your own gifts and abilities to do the work of proclamation, healing, and demon exorcism that Jesus assigns to you. Don't worry too much about that. Because see, your authorization doesn't rest in your talent and abilities. You are doing this work because Jesus has sent you. He has assigned you. You are disciples. So it doesn't begin first with your faith in Jesus, but because of Jesus' faith and what his love can do working through you, you have been sent. So I declare to you on this 4th of July, in the celebration of our 100th year in this space, happy founding day of the church. Let us begin this celebration of our founding, this celebration of us being the community of faith. Let us begin it with the greatest invitation of all, the invitation to come and sup with me. That is an invitation that no one can discredit. It's intimate. When you invite someone into your house, into your space, and say, come put your feet under my table, it means that I trust you, I know you, and I love you, and you are welcome here. Let us begin our time together. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Let us offer each other signs of reconciliation and love. Now, we're not going to get up and visit, but just offer those right near you. The peace of God be with you. The Lord be with you.
And also with
you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven. We praise your name and join their unending hymn. God the power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. Deliver us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Says that Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ come in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let us pray. Our Creator God,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Now today we're gonna serve the communion by intention. That was not our intent, but I think the church was trying to see would I perform a miracle on my first communion service. We look high and low, and we cannot find our individual box of elements. So those who feel comfortable taking communion by intention, we will invite you for it. Elaine and Richard will be helping us with that. Those who don't feel comfortable, we understand, don't feel any way of guilt. But we invite you to come. your hands up.
The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Thank you.
frustrated brother. See how he's tried to light his own candle some other way. See now your sister, she's been robbed and lied to, still holds a candle without a flame. So carry your candle, run to the darkness, seek out.
Amen. Let us share together in our benediction that's in your bulletins. Lord, what you have asked is not easy to do. The task is so big and requires the best and the worst of us. It is not easy to bury the ego, but we must for the sake of your mission. Reconciliation is more than what we bargain for. And training costs more than what we expected to pay.
With your spirit, we'll reconcile
with the boldness of the Holy Spirit, we'll do your work anyway. Amen.